Class, good evening. What I want to do with this lecture is to take you as quickly as I can through the ascension and reign of Henry VII, or Henry Tudor. I won't spend a lot of time on him, and that's probably unfair to him. He is a very interesting individual. He is relegated to a spot in history as being the father of Henry VIII, and he was really much more than that. He was an underrated or maybe underestimated individual who came off of rather an obscure page in history, seized the British crown, and turned the direction of history dramatically on that fateful day in August of 1485 at the Battle of Bosworth Field. And I had you all watch a video for me. It looked like it was pretty good. I looked through several of those on YouTube, and I wanted to give you something that would give you an indication of what a dramatic turn of events, not just violence on the field, but how this upended the Plantagenet dynasty, ostensibly settling the feud between the Lancastrian and Yorkist branches, but really it was the end of the Plantagenets. And you can say you had a merger, as it were, between the Yorks and the Lancasters and the beautiful Tudor Rose, as you all hopefully have explored a little bit. But what it really represented was the beginning of a brand new dynasty. And that, of course, was the Tudor dynasty. A dynasty that was destined to be brief, but dramatic, and certainly the most colorful that has been in English history, I think. Many are partial to the Stuarts. Others, of course, are modern Windsors. But the Tudors, you just can't beat them for the color and the drama and just the very fact that they, I think that the Tudors put, how can I say this, England unquestionably on the map as a dynamic and independent nation. The Hundred Years' War and its aftermath had shown the folly of trying to have one king over two great nations, England and France. The War of the Roses, 32 plus years, maybe almost 33, will show England that warring families competing for the crown, that was just a ridiculous expenditure of life and the realm's treasury. And I believe that Henry Tudor, that once he was successful on this battlefield, once he claimed the crown for himself, once Parliament conferred the title on him, and then once he married Elizabeth of York, he wanted peace and stability for the realm more than anything else. So our turn of events are rather quick, unfold rather quickly. August 22nd, 1485, we have the Battle of Bosworth Field. October 30th, he is crowned, and then Parliament confirms the title on him, or affirms the crowning, confirms the title in November. And then January 18th, 1486, Henry marries the beautiful Elizabeth York, and the two lines are merged through matrimony. And this becomes really for Henry a way to solve problems. He sees that marriage is a lot cheaper than war, and he has that in mind for his children to continue that. You know, you solve a problem with another nation through a fortuitous marriage or a planned marriage that is very fortunate for them. So Henry had a couple of issues with which to deal, and we're still talking about Henry VII. Henry VII will have a couple of issues with which to deal that I want to talk to you a little bit about today, and then we'll move on towards our Renaissance King, Henry VIII. One of the problems that he had when he came to the throne, where there were still Yorkists or those supporters or members of the family, the York line of the Plantagenets, that believed that he was just another usurper and that he had no rightful place on the throne. Well, and then to make matters worse, he will have to deal with what I call a series of pretenders. And your textbook talks about this. These are individuals who claim to be a legitimate heir. And one particularly infamous individual named Perkin Warbeck will claim to be one of the lost boys in the tower, the youngest of the two brothers who died most certainly by the hand or at least the order of Richard III. Warbeck posed as the younger brother, who I believe his name was also Richard, as I say, and he will cause a great deal of trouble. He has a following. He has a very strong following in France, who by now, even though they supported Henry Tudor when he came to the, you know, to compete for his place in on the throne, now those good feelings are gone, and Henry is finding himself at odds with the French, which shouldn't surprise anybody. So Warbeck has a sympathetic ear with the French, and there is a significant movement trying to make sure that he has the crown, and I don't think there's any historicity to his claim or his identity at all. He will end up losing his life, and that was probably the best thing that could happen. He's an interesting character. If you're still searching for someone for a life, you might not can find a whole lot on him with the limitations of our resources, but he's really interesting. And certainly Henry VII is also. So one of his problems is he had to deal with these claimants, these Yorkist claimants, with these pretenders. Warbeck is not the only one of these, and he deals with them fairly harshly, and I think to try to put an end to them. Henry's other problem is really with his children, and it's primarily with his oldest son. I believe that Henry VII had a very successful marriage with Elizabeth, and they had a lot of children. But there were only four who made it to adulthood. The oldest was Arthur, who we know will not live to actually reach, I think, the age of 16. He has a younger sister, Margaret, and then Henry, and then Mary. And there are two other children that are born in that line, and they do not survive into I think the youngest daughter, Catherine, lived for just days. And there was one other child who lived just a short period of time, maybe two or three years. Don't quote me on that. But it wasn't unusual. And there may have been one more. It wasn't unusual at all to have children who died very young. But I don't know of any stories, anecdotal or historical, about Henry being having illegitimate children. I think their marriage was successful. And they named their first son, their first child, Arthur, and that is absolutely deliberate. That is not a coincidence. I believe that he wanted Arthur to be a symbol of England's coming greatness, and to inspire his people as king, you know, drawing on the great reputation of this Celtic king. And if I am not mistaken, Henry Tudor had Welsh blood, and there is significant proof that if our understanding of Arthur, he was a Celtic king, Welsh, Irish, he had that Celtic blood. So Arthur is a perfect name for this new son. Henry wanted for his country a king who represented and lived out a spirit of chivalry, patriotism, and just would strengthen the bonds between the king's person, and the people, and the nobles. Bring everybody together under the leadership of this one man who would be represent the merging of the two fractured lines of the Plantagenets, and drawing on England's history and shining a light into her future. Now, as I told you, Henry Tudor, Henry the Seventh, he does not want his nation to be embroiled in endless, pointless international struggles. And right now, probably the biggest threat is France. He wants a close relationship. I could chase a rabbit all day long with this. This is European thought. These young nations, as they are forming, they think there's strength in numbers. So you have a relationship with one nation, so the two of you can gang up on the other. And you and I will see next year in modern Europe and in the era of the world wars how these alliances became so costly to Europe and really is at the heart of so many of these terrible, terrible wars. Anyway, Henry, our good king, wants to ensure that he has a close friend to stand with him against France. And that alliance might, in fact, be a deterrent. Not necessarily so they can just go beat up France together, but the essence of that alliance might deter France from being involved in a war with them. So Henry did not like to overtax his people. He did not necessarily want to spend any additional money or lives in wars that were just going to end up draining the treasury further. And he thought that a way to keep peace in the realm, keep everyone, keep enemies at bay, would be through these alliances. And the best way to forge these alliances was through a marriage. And he will betroth Arthur at quite a young age. I think Arthur was just about 3, and this was not unusual, when this contract, this marriage contract, was put into place with a beautiful Spanish princess, Catherine of Aragon. And her parents are very famous. You know her parents, Ferdinand and Isabella. And she was a prize, I think, and he was a prize. This marriage would strengthen the bond between Spain and England, and they could stand firmly against France. And, it was a great idea. It's a great idea. And you all remember from the drama that we watched, the Masterpiece Theater, The Six Wives of Henry VIII, I believe they would have had a successful marriage. He was very young when they are finally married, about 15, which is not as young as it is today. But we know the rest of the story, sadly, is that though they are married, he experiences some assault on his health, whether it was pneumonia or it could have even been the plague, because the plague still appeared from time to time. We're not sure what it was. But he is going to die unexpectedly, and it's important for me to tell you this before the marriage was consummated. This is going to be a major issue down the road. And as we saw, poor Catherine was she had no place to go. She couldn't go back to Spain. She had to wait and see what was going to happen. Not only is she heartbroken over the loss of her husband, but she is really a princess without a realm. And so she has to wait to see what's going to happen to her. Is she going to actually be able to marry Arthur's younger brother, Henry, to fulfill the marriage contract? We know that that drama was very painful for her. I believe she remains the most popular of Henry's wives with English historians and the people. I'm not sure of that. It's only Americans that really tend to like Anne Boleyn. But she will. We know that Catherine will be married to Henry and the younger son. And they have initially a fabulously successful marriage. They are very well designed for one another. Now, for Henry to marry his brother's widow, he had to get a special dispensation from the Pope, from the church, saying that this marriage is acceptable in the eyes of God. Scripture does not forbid it. I give my permission. So that's very important to remember. And this turned on this, permission, this dispensation turned on the fact that Catherine and Arthur had never consummated their marriage. There was a few years ago, I wish I hadn't read it, there was a historical fiction written by, I'm sure it's just a pseudonym, a pen name, by a woman named Philippa Gregory, and she has made $1 billion with these quasi-historical novels that she writes. But she wrote, I was just so disappointed, but she wrote sort of a novelization of the relationship between Arthur and Catherine, which, you know, that really does stretch the imagination. There's no historical source work for that. And I thought it was an abomination after I got into it. She just completely changed the character of Catherine. I think it's very important for us to accept Catherine and her claims about their marriage on face value. I don't think she was a woman who would have said that if the other side were true. And we'll see how important that is. So I hope you have, through this very brief look at Henry VII. Let me just say this sort of to recap. And then when we come back, I'll have a full lecture on Henry VIII. But I want you to understand that Henry VII was a very good king, a sound king, one who, even though he came to the throne in some of the most dramatic circumstances imaginable, he nevertheless wanted stability and peace for his nation. He wanted to establish a dynasty which would endure, and he wanted to transcend this image of, well, here's another usurper. Here's just somebody else who's claimed the throne through might. He wanted to prove himself to be a grand and good king, and I think that's the best way to understand him. He was practical. He was not frivolous in his expenditures. He was forward-thinking much more than anyone would give him credit for, I think, at first glance. He actually will support some of the exploratory efforts of John Cabot, Giovanni Caboto, as his real name is, and some of those early exploration of the Atlantic coast of the Americas. So he's someone who is... he takes this very seriously, and his motives, I think, are pure. There's blood on his hands, but there's blood on everybody's hands. And I think he probably was underestimated even by those who supported him and thought perhaps he might be someone who could be used to do their own bidding. But he is an interesting character. Please read carefully in your text. She does such a better job fleshing this out than I will. His two problems, again, I think the two key problems that he had in his realm was, first, establishing himself and his name in the presence of some of the skepticism about him, and then these ridiculous pretenders. And then the other problem is the heartbreaking death of his oldest son, upon whom he had pinned so much of his desire for the realm. He was a good king and got the Tudors off to a good start. I feel like, and I have a British friend who watches these or listens to these videos, I feel like his claim, that Henry VII's claim to the throne, was tenuous in terms of the proper order, as you and I have talked about. in terms of the bloodline, as you and I have talked about. I think it was tenuous at best. But let me say this in conclusion. I believe that's in part why his son Henry was so antsy, so hinky about having a string of boys to succeed him. They didn't want another nightmare queen like Maud, Matilda, and neither did they want to have the family dynasty to appear to be unstable. So our two problems he is able to overcome in the sense of dealing with the skepticism, dealing with the pretenders, and then he had, even though the death of Arthur, he had a son who was able to succeed his younger brother once Henry himself had passed away. When we come back, we will delve into what so many of you have been waiting for. We will talk about Henry VIII, his, I won't say split personality, but his personality will change dramatically. And I think perhaps it's true that power corrupts, but we'll see if we can measure some of the changes that he brings about in England, and then move towards those characters with whom you've become very familiar through your reading, Prince and then King Edward, Prince Edward really, Queen Mary, and Queen Elizabeth. So I hope you all are doing well. My internet has gone out. We were told that there was an area failure. We don't know what's going on. So I'm going to go to school tomorrow and see if I can have this uploaded. I'm not sure if I can do it there or not, but we'll get it all straightened out as soon as we can. I have received an email where there's some questions about, you know, what's due and when. Please make sure you're getting the look at the announcements in the online classroom, and make sure you're getting the group emails that I have sent out for HI 350. If you're not, let me know, and I can resend them. If any of you need a syllabus, another copy of the syllabus, or anything else, let me know. And I appreciate your patience, and we're getting through this together. And I look forward to hopefully being able to see some of you before too very long. And please don't hesitate to email me, and as soon as I can, I will respond. Thanks a lot, and you all have a good night. Bye-bye.